At first glance, the history of the Chernobyl disaster seems well documented. Yet, there are some stories with large blank spots. One of them is about two locomotives equipped with red capsules for their operators. And almost 40 years after they were built, their exact purpose still remains unclear. But today we might come closer to an answer. This is their story. It was Friday evening, June 6, 1986. 41 days had passed since the Chernobyl disaster, and intensive decontamination work was ongoing day and night at the nuclear power plant. The goal at that time was to prepare the site for constructing the sarcophagus over the destroyed reactor 4. Meanwhile, 400 miles away, in Moscow, two men entered the headquarters of the Ministry of Railways. Those were Sergei Sudakov, head of the Design Bureau of Locomotive Department, and his boss, Evgeny Dubchenko. The first deputy minister who met them got straight to the point. At Chernobyl nuclear power plant, they need protected locomotives. The physicist said that a 50mm layer of lead would provide the necessary protection. Two machines must be ready in 2 weeks. So that said, whatever you need, we'll provide it. And now go and get to work. So the call later recalled that no one ever explained the exact purpose of what they were building. One official, however, during an inspection vaguely mentioned that the train would move some sort of containers with concrete and steel, but refused to give any further details. That very evening, Sudakov shared the task with his colleagues, and they quickly realized that was quite a tricky challenge. A 50mm or 2-inch layer of lead around the trainman's cabin would add roughly 25 tons to the locomotive. It was far more than a chassis could handle. But suddenly, Igor Timofeyev, a specialist in shunting locomotives who also was present at the meeting, proposed a solution. A protective capsule containing all controls could be placed on a separate railway platform, making the locomotive unmanned and preserving its weight limits. This idea was met with the great enthusiasm, so Sudakov called Dubchenko, who promptly secured the locomotives from the factory in Bryansk. Those were brand new shunting engines, type TEM-2U, with numbers 8515 and 8519. By Monday, on the Lublin railway depot in Moscow, the assembly process began. Over the weekend, rolls of lead had been delivered, and they were very, very large. One participant later recalled, "In the workshop, there were massive sheets of lead, and workers from various shops used axes and sledgehammers to cut them into smaller plates. An electric cart constantly transported the plates to the repair workshop. There were prepared two standard railway platforms. An overhead crane lifted the lead plates onto the platforms where workers assembled capsules using blow torches by positioning panels on the welded steel frame. The capsules measured roughly 2.5 to 4 meters or 8 to 13 feet and stood about 3 meters or 10 feet tall. In some places, the walls were nearly 30 centimeters or 12 inches thick, built like a sandwich with a lead shot poured between lead sheets. Each capsule had a small access hatch and 4 tiny observation windows lined with thick yellow anti-radiation glass. The visibility was not very good, but it is still unknown if it was all or they also included some sort of cameras or periscopes. On top of each capsule, engineers installed a powerful light projector and a filter ventilation system. But unlike the crash drags we discussed earlier, which used standard military filter systems, these locomotives featured a rather creative solution. The depot specialized in Czechoslovak locomotives like ČS4, so engineers decided to use spare air conditioners from those. They connected air conditioners to large filters using L-shaped pipes, providing superior performance and a comfortable climate inside the capsules. But constructing the capsules was only half of the job, because next came setting up the controls. This is what they look like at this locomotive. There is a control panel which displays operation of all systems. There is a main controller, which is basically a huge multi-position switch that wires electric sockets of the machine during the movement. And there is a main pneumatic valve, which also has few positions and controls the brake system. The spare control panels arrived from Bryansk's factory along with the engines. But they were of poor quality, so technicians had to rework them very much before installing them inside the capsules. Additionally, on another side of the capsule for easier operation was added a handheld control panel, given the limited visibility from the windows. All this was connected using a set of multi-core cables with their entire length on the platform surface covered and sealed with red strips. By June 18, less than 2 weeks after the initial directive, both machines were ready. After basic testing, they were sent to the Chernobyl exclusion zone, and because of the distance, the journey took a few days. And during this time, engineers finalized documentation, because in fact all what they did was based just on their pencil sketches. Once in the zone, the locomotives underwent a series of extensive tests of their protective capabilities. But what happened next is largely a mystery. Some verbal accounts suggest that locomotives helped move sarcophagus components to the construction site. Likely, they were also used to push the train we told you about in our previous episode, which later was concreted in the place, becoming the Southern Pioneer Wall. Beyond that, their role is still unclear, but there is this single image which provides a clue. So it shows the famous Japanese Komatsu bulldozer. About this very interesting machine we'll have a separate episode, but right now look at the background. There is one of the locomotives with a specialized rail car. And this is a rail car designed for transporting nuclear fuel. So it might be that apart from help with construction works, the actual main purpose of those trains was completely different. Specifically, to move nuclear fuel between the three intact units and the storage, which was finished in rush during the months following the disaster. It was needed because those units were passing a massive modernization to be restarted again. But transportation of nuclear fuel normally is a highly secured operation. And given the added total secrecy in 1986, this might be an exact reason why there are no images of these trains working. The fate of lead capsules remains a mystery as well, though logically they could have heavy contamination due to their filtering systems, which means they likely ended in the ditches at the Burekivka disposal site. The locomotives themselves, however, were luckier, and I remember seeing them with my own eyes in 2012 at the Yaniv train station near the city of Pripyat. Before the shutdown of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant in 2000, this railway station was an active logistical hub of the Chernobyl zone. The station was operated by Chernobyl Service, a special state company responsible for infrastructure management of the Chernobyl zone. So both machines were transferred to this entity where they continued to operate in a regional manned way. For many years they were regularly used to move cargo mostly on the line Vilcha-Yaniv. But sometimes they went outside the zone as well, to Ovruch, for repairs. 8515 was more contaminated, so when its technical condition worsened, it was left behind on a side track, and eventually it was disposed in 2016. However, 8519 still exists, and it's almost fully functional. But after some trespasser made a graffiti on it, it was moved from outdoor storage to one of dry hangars. If you think about this for a moment, in a larger scale, all this story is an epitome of how things were done during the most intense period of the Chernobyl disaster. On one hand, the engineers' efforts undoubtedly deserve the highest respect. But on the other hand, a quick look at the map reveals how actually inefficiently it was organized. There were plenty of facilities in Ukraine capable of handling this task. And yet it was easier to bring two engines from Bryansk to Moscow and then transport them nearly 600 miles by rail to the Chernobyl zone. But after all, these were different times and resources seemed unlimited. Speaking of lead capsules, there was one more even more extreme example, so-called Chernobyl batiskafs. These were one or two person capsules that provided excellent protection. They were attached to the mag cranes, which lowered them into the very opening of reactor 4, allowing engineers to observe the structure up close. This provided critical information needed for the design of a sarcophagus, but that's a story for the next episodes. Until then, check out our Patreon for bonus content, archive materials and unique insights into Chernobyl. This episode is a part of a series, so check out our other documentaries, because we have many fascinating stories to share. Thank you for watching and see you next time in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.